right there.
For the Roberts Commission until August 1944. I appeared before the Pearl Harbor Board, but again was not permitted to hear the other witnesses, nor was given the privilege of cross-examination. However, I was furnished a copy of the hearings, except for the part considered top secret. The Army Board labeled certain evidence top secret, and I was never permitted to see that until just about the time this committee was to meet. Both boards took testimony off the record, which has never been made available to me. Before taking up my statement in detail, there are a few points that I would like to mention for emphasis. These will be elaborated upon later. One, on Pearl Harbor Day, I was carrying out orders from the War Department as I understood them. Two, at no time since June 17, 1940, had the War Department indicated the probability of an attack on Hawaii. In none of the estimates prepared by G2 War Department was Hawaii mentioned as a point of attack, but the Philippines were mentioned repeatedly. Three, there was in the War Department an abundance of information which was vital to me, but which was not furnished to me. This information was absolutely essential to a correct estimate of the situation and a correct decision. My estimate of the situation and my decision were made without the benefit of this vital information. Had this information been furnished to me, I am sure that I would have arrived at the conclusion that Hawaii would be attacked and would have gone on an all-out alert. Fourth, when I made the decision, based on the information available, to go on alert to prevent sabotage, I reported measures taken as follows. Reference your radiogram number 472-27th, report department alerted to prevent sabotage, liaison with the Navy. The War Department had 9 days in which to tell me that my action was not what they wanted. I accepted their silence as a full agreement with the action taken. I am convinced that all who read the report felt that my action was correct, or I would have received instructions to modify my orders. I would like to pass out at this time a chart. I also conferred with General Giroux in the War Plans Division. I talked with some officer about the equipment of the Hawaiian Department. I talked with Colonel, now called Rainbow 5 by the Army, and WPL 46 by the Navy. This plan could be put into effect only by the War and Navy Departments. The Joint Coastal Frontier Defense Plan for Hawaii was approved by Admiral Block and me on 11 April 1941, based, of course, on the Rainbow Plan. Under this plan, the Navy undertook responsibility for distance reconnaissance. No part of this joint plan would take effect until the War Department ordered M-Day under the Rainbow Plan. Unless it was ordered into effect from Washington, I would never have ordered any part of the plan into effect without consulting it, as long as communications were open and time permitted. Under the second distance reconnaissance. On November 27th, I received the following radiogram from the Chief of Staff which, on account of its conflicting instructions, the Army Pearl Harbor Board called the do-don't message. Number 472, negotiations with the Japanese appear to be terminated to all practical purposes, with only the barest possibilities that the Japanese government might come back and offer to continue. Japanese future action unpredictable, but hostile action possible at any moment. If hostilities cannot be avoided, the United States desires that Japan commit the first overt act. This policy should not, repeat not, be construed as restricting you to a course of action that might jeopardize your defense. Prior to the hostile Japanese action, you are directed to undertake such reconnaissance and other measures and or disclose intent. Report measures taken. Should hostilities occur, you will carry out the tasks assigned in Rainbow 5 so far as they pertain to Japan. Limit the dissemination of this highly secret information to the minimum essential officers. The impression conveyed to me by this message was that the avoidance of war was paramount, and that the greatest fear of the War Department was that some international incident might occur in Hawaii and be regarded by Japan as an overt act. That this opinion, no mention was ever made of a probable attack on Hawaii since the alert message of June 17, 1940. An examination of the various military intelligence estimates prepared by G2 War Department shows that in no estimate did G2 ever indicate the probability of an attack on Hawaii. There was nothing in the message directing me to be prepared to meet an air raid or an all-out attack. Hostile action at any moment meant to me that as far as Hawaii was concerned, the War Department was predicting sabotage. Sabotage is a form of hostile action. From repeated conversations with the Navy, I knew that the Japanese naval vessels were supposed to be either in their home ports or proceeding south. I had no information suggesting that some ships might have been detached to proceed eastward. Our information also indicated that Japan had no land-based bombers capable of proceeding from their nearest island some 2,100 miles away. It was my statement. The danger of sabotage was paramount in my mind and seemed to me to be the chief danger which the War Department feared. Sabotage had long been considered our primary danger in Hawaii because of the large Japanese population, many of whom were under suspicion of disloyalty. 37% of the population was of Japanese descent, or probably 161,000. Of those, about 40,000 were Japanese aliens. Many of the Japanese lived in very close proximity to airfields and other defense installations. Sabotage might reasonably be expected for several months prior to the outbreak of hostilities. Would you pass out chart number 5, please? Early on the morning of December 7th, which, if interpreted differently at the time, might have had a very decided effect upon the action that followed. About 6:45, a two-man submarine entering Pearl Harbor was destroyed by ships on duty. Had the naval authorities foreseen this as a possible forerunner of an air attack or notified the Army, time would have been available for the dispersion of the planes. However, the naval authorities did not connect this submarine attack with a possible general attack. The Army was not notified until after the attack.